Can you hear me? Yeah, start Pratima.
Okay. Sorry, I had some internet issues. I'm very sorry for joining in late. But can we start now, Kala? All the members
Yes,
are missing.
please start.
Okay. Good evening and a warm welcome to honorable speakers, guests, and members. I'm Pratima, and on behalf of ICI Singapore, I thank you all for taking time out from your busy schedule and attending yet another engaging session by ICI Singapore. Today's event is a topic of discussion, the most awaited topic of discussion, and an annual exercise that all of us, especially the CAs, look forward to. Also, it is very special because we have with us His Excellency, High Commissioner of India to Singapore, Mr. P. Kumaran, to grace the occasion. But before we begin the session, I would like to make an announcement. As many of you may know, ICI India has recently announced the winners for the best overseas chapter for the current term. And it gives me immense pleasure to mention that ICI Singapore chapter has been awarded the second best overseas chapter by the parent institute. So let us all take a moment to applaud the efforts of the chairperson, our chairperson, Ms. Kala, and the working committee. And big congratulations to all the past chairpersons and the members. Ms. Kala, I request you to now address the members. Thank you.
Thank you, Pratima. Good evening. Greetings from ICI Singapore chapter. Welcome, His Excellency, Honorable High Commissioner to India, Mr. P. Kumaran, Mr. Bhupati, ICA past president. A budget is not a number. It reflects the values and priorities of the nation and its people. A budget tells you your money where to go rather than wondering where it went. Our finance minister recently presented the first ever digital union budget. It focused on providing a major boost to healthcare and infrastructure. India's fight against COVID-19 continues into 2021, and that this moment in history when the political, economic, and strategic relations in the post-COVID world are changing is the dawn of a new era in which India is well poised to truly be the land of promise and hope. Does the budget provide every opportunity for the economy to capture the pace and grow sustainably? Well, to know about this, the budget highlights and understand the subtle nuances, we have CA Gagan Malik, Ernst & Young partner, to speak, followed by a small panel discussion with Ms. Karishma Nagar from Pricewaterhouse and Ms. Payal Tuli from Deloitte. It is our privilege and honor to have today His Excellency, Honorable High Commissioner to India, Mr. P. Kumaran. I would kindly invite him to deliver a few words to our members. Please, sir. So you have to unmute.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. Mr. Ramanathan Bhupathi, past president ICAI, Ms. Kala Krishnamurthy, chairperson ICAI Singapore chapter, Mr. Gagan Malik, partner Ernst & Young, Ms. Payal Tuli, partner Deloitte, Ms. Karishma Nagar, manager PwC, other esteemed dignitaries, investors, and professionals who have joined us virtually today. Good evening to all of you. It's indeed a pleasure to join you all today to discuss India's budget 2021-22 again. I was just mentioning before the event started that this is actually the third event on the budget I'm attending today. But I'm delighted to see the kind of interest there is in Singapore for the details of India's tax and investment policies. as outlined in the budget. This is only perhaps natural given the deep trade and investment links between India and Singapore, and the fact that Singapore is the largest investor in India in terms of the cumulative investments made over the years, which today exceed $106 billion. We have several experts speaking later today on the details of the tax proposals. I will therefore limit myself in my remarks to highlighting some aspects of the India-Singapore trade and investment relationship, and of course, some key aspects of the budget from the standpoint of the High Commission to the extent that they relate to our trade and investment promotion efforts. I have a number of items to highlight, so if I exceed the time allotted to me by a minute or two, please do pardon me for that. Let me start by highlighting some aspects of the bilateral trade and investment relationship. The Comprehensive Economic Cooperation Agreement, CECA, between India and Singapore was signed in June 2005 and became operational a couple of months later. It established a comprehensive framework to enhance trade in goods and services, promote investments, mutually recognize qualifications in key areas, and facilitate movement of persons. Along with this, an improved double taxation avoidance agreement and a more liberal air services agreement were also signed around the same time. The expectation was that Singapore, as a key enabler of re-export trade and a country that hosts regional headquarters of hundreds of international companies, would help India leverage Singapore's strengths in finance, manufacturing, marketing and services, and also help us achieve greater competitiveness, allowing us to use it as a gateway to Southeast Asia. As far as Singapore is concerned, it was seen to offer access to the huge and growing Indian market for goods and services, including finance, and to enable connections between regional supply chains and also serve as a key option to source qualified professionals. Since the signing of CECA in 2005, the India-Singapore partnership has witnessed a significant expansion. Trade between the two countries rose from under 7 billion to reach an all-time high of about 27 billion. Our exports from about $2.1 billion in 2003-04 rose to about close to $17 billion in 2011-12. In subsequent years, they've dropped slightly, and they are currently in the range of about $9 billion US dollars. On the other hand, the total trade has also reduced somewhat to reach a little under $13 billion, dropping almost 25% from the high of $24 billion achieved in 2019-20. But this decrease has largely been due to the effects of the pandemic. Today, Singapore is India's largest trade partner in ASEAN. It is also India's seventh largest trade partner globally, with a share of 3% of India's overall trade. Over the last 20 years, the total investment into India from Singapore is more than 106 billion US dollars, accounting for nearly 21% of the total FDI inflows. In fact, in 2019-20 alone, the inflow from Singapore was just under 15 billion US dollars. Even during the pandemic, Singapore was one of the largest investors into India, accounting for slightly under 3 billion US dollars. On the other hand, India's investment into Singapore over the years has been about 71 billion US dollars. It's also noteworthy that more than 80% of listed offshore bonds by Indian issuers are listed on the Singapore Stock Exchange. More than 440 companies from Singapore are registered in India, while over 8,000 Indian companies are registered in Singapore. The bilateral air services agreement was signed in 1968 and subsequently revised and upgraded three times. Singapore, before the COVID pandemic started, was connected to 18 Indian cities by 8 airlines. And there were more than 500 weekly flights both ways in total. Also in 2019, About 1.42 million Indian tourists visited Singapore, making India the third largest source of tourism to Singapore. Let me now turn to the key proposals in the budget. I'll try and highlight some of the important ones. Clearly, that won't be an exhaustive list, but I'll try and stick to the time allotted to me. This budget was a historical one, given that it was presented amidst extraordinary times, a pandemic on a rampage, a deepening economic and healthcare crisis, simultaneous demand and supply shocks, stagnation in credit flows, fiscal constraints, and an uncertain global geopolitical environment. All this made the budget making process this year very daunting. The finance minister outlined her budget vision on six pillars, but the overall theme was that the government went for a significant push towards growth by triggering an investment cycle, especially in the areas of infrastructure and asset creation, simultaneously with social sector expenditure aimed at generating equitable growth. The aim was to achieve a V-shaped recovery and propel the economy forward towards the target of a $5 trillion GDP. This, of course, required the government to deviate from the fiscal consolidation roadmap to pursue a bold policy aimed at reviving growth. The key highlights, therefore, are the unveiling of some bold economic reforms, including in the financial sector, to create new opportunities for global capital, creation of some new institutions, a big push to manufacturing in India, and also focus on healthcare in a big way. As you've seen over the last few days, the government has provided a massive boost to infrastructure spending for key projects. More economic and highway corridors are being planned to augment the road infrastructure. The National Infrastructure Pipeline, which was launched about a year ago with about 6,800 projects, has now expanded to include 7,400 projects to enhance the capacity to finance infrastructure projects. The government has decided to set up a development financial institution. An allocation of about $3 billion has been earmarked to capitalize this institution. The National Infrastructure Pipeline will also receive funding through monetization of existing assets, such as dedicated railway freight corridors, airports, operational toll roads, oil and gas pipelines of GAIL, transmission assets of Power Grid Corporation of India Limited, sports stadiums, etc. A national monetization pipeline and an asset monetization dashboard are to be created to facilitate this process and to provide greater visibility to investors. NHAI and PGCIL, Power Grid Corporation, are also to set up infrastructure investment trusts, InvITs, to attract global funds into these sectors. There's been a massive increase of outlays for Ministry of Road Transport and Highways and the Ministry of Railways, with large amounts being spent on capital expenditure. The eastern and western dedicated freight corridors are pushed forward to be commissioned by June 2022. In terms of urban infrastructure, about $2.5 billion have been allocated to support augmentation of public bus transport services. New metro technologies are being introduced for deployment in tier two cities and peripheral areas of tier one cities. The government is also introducing a new voluntary vehicle scrapping policy to phase out old and unfit vehicles. This is also expected to help with climate change issues, in addition to increasing demand for newer automobiles. To promote exports, major ports are being moved from managing their own operations to a model where a private partner can help manage it for them. For this purpose, seven projects will be offered under the PPP mode. Five major fishing harbor harbors are being identified for modernization. A multipurpose seaweed park is also proposed in Tamil Nadu with an eye on export markets. In the power sector, a new framework is being put in place to promote competition amongst distribution companies and provide alternatives to consumers where they can choose between one provider or the other. Similarly, for transport of natural gas, a gas transport system operator, which can offer carrier capacity to any potential user is also being set up. Another strong move in this budget is that of disinvestment. This is expected to offer more opportunities to global companies for investment in India. In fact, according to the new approach, except for four strategic areas, atomic energy, space and defense, transport and telecommunications, power, petroleum, coal and other minerals, and banking, insurance and financial services. Except for these four areas, PSUs in all other sectors will be divested. The government has set an ambitious disinvestment target of about $23.3 billion. In addition to IDBI, two other public sector banks, LIC, which is to be divested through an IPO, BPCL, Air India Shipping Corporation, BML, and a number of other companies. Their disinvestment is to be completed by 2021-22. In terms of reforms and consolidation of the financial sector, the government has allocated 20,000 crore for recapitalization of public sector banks. It has also decided to create a bad bank in the form of an asset reconstruction and management company for stressed assets management in a way that generates greater confidence in India for foreign investors. Other bold steps, such as raising the FDI limit in the insurance sector from 49% to 74%, and also allowing foreign ownership with some safeguards, will open up the sector in a big way to international players. Seven mega textile parks are being set up under the Mitra scheme, with the aim of creating world-class infrastructure with plug-and-play facilities for investors to enable India's textile industry to become an integral part of global supply chains. As you're aware, the government has also already announced production-linked incentives for 13 priority sectors to boost manufacturing in India. Rationalization of labor laws was recently completed. More reforms targeting the MSME space have recently been initiated, including allowing non-banking finance companies to extend invoice financing to MSMEs. The government is also rolling out a data center park policy to incentivize the setting up of data centers in India. As far as taxation changes are concerned, we'll be hearing from the experts who speak after me, but I just wanted to point out a couple of them. Tax holidays for startups extended by one more year, capital gains tax exemption for investment of proceeds in eligible startups, and a significant expansion in the definition of small scale companies. There are also a number of measures pertaining to banking, insurance, and the bond market to make the financial sector future ready. In addition to this, there are measures related to the International Financial Services Center, IFSC, to promote it as an international finance hub. These include exemptions from capital gains for funds relocating to IFSC before 31st March 2023, tax concessions for aircraft lease companies in GIFT City, and a number of other measures. There are also clarifications to help sovereign wealth funds and pension funds understand the investment environment in India better. A permanent institutional framework for a corporate bond market is also being created. Under the objective of minimum government and maximum governance, the government has taken several steps, such as extending decriminalization of business laws to limited liability partnerships under the Companies Act, setting up a dispute resolution committee to reduce litigation amongst taxpayers, strengthening of the National Company Law Tribunal framework for speedy dispute resolution, and making the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal faceless and jurisdictionless. In addition, the reduction of the time limit for reopening assessments to 3 years, except for tax evasion related cases, shows the government's intention to reduce litigation and minimize uncertainty for taxpayers. There's also a revised customs duty policy that is due to come out in the next few months to facilitate easier compliance for traders and reduce the regulatory burden on them. In fact, there is also a massive increase in healthcare outlay by 137%. The PM Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat Yojana is to be launched with an outlay of $8.8 billion over 6 years. And the government has allocated $5 billion for the COVID-19 mass vaccination program. And the finance minister has assured more allocations should the need arise. So broadly, these are the points that I wanted to highlight. I'm sure our experts have more details on these to explain to our participants today. The expectation from this budget is that the bold initiatives will help in re-energizing the economy and return it to a high growth trajectory. Industry has broadly welcomed it for its focus on investments, infrastructure, ease of doing business, and stability and predictability. There is a fairly wide consensus that it will help growth revival by catalyzing demand and reviving investments and promoting a new cycle of investments. Thank you very much. I look forward to listening to the other participants.
Thank you so much, sir, for your summary of the budget. As you said, yes, the aim is to have a V-shaped recovery. And as you said, the expenditure on providing a major boost to infrastructure and health. And once again, thank you amidst your busy schedule. And you know that today you have been continuously attending the events. And still, thanks for accepting our invitation and to grace the event today. Once again, thank you very much, sir. And also when you are speaking about Atmanirbhar, Mr. Mahavir Singh, we had a session last week, and I think you were busy. So he is busy today. He could not join. And he has conveyed his regards to you as well. So because of his busy schedule, he could not join today. Once again, thank you, sir. And over to you, Pratima.
Thank you, Kala. I would now like to introduce our next speaker, Mr. Bhupati. Mr. Bhupati is an alumni of the prestigious Vivekananda College of Chennai and a fellow member of the Institute. He has served as the past president of ICAI and has held several advisory positions as a member of the Education Committee of International Federation of Accountants and Accounting Research Foundation of ICAI. He is a recipient of the Paramacharya Award and also Certification Award by Confederation of Asia Pacific Accountants for his contributions to the accountancy profession. In fact, there are a lot of his students in our chapter, including our chairperson, Kala. So welcome, Mr. Bhupati. It is a great pleasure to have you with us. I request you to please present the keynote address.
The chairperson of Singapore chapter, Kala Krishnamurthy, His Excellency, High Commissioner of India, Sri Kumaran, the panelists, CA Gagan Malik, CA Payal Thuli, CA Krishna Nagar. It's my pleasure and privilege to deliver the keynote address in this event organized by the Singapore chapter of ICAI. Before I begin my address, let me congratulate Singapore chapter for being awarded the second best overseas chapter, and it's definitely a good recognition. Continue the good work and by contributing to the growth of our profession. Let me begin by saying the finance minister, while presenting the Union Budget 2021, did go on record to say that this is the first budget after the contraction of the economy. She further added that there were three other situations where budgets were presented after contraction of the economy. But she said, in all the three earlier occasions, it was typical to India. The contraction was typical to India, but whereas this contraction in economy has got a global impact. That is why when His Excellency addressed us, he also mentioned that not only people from India are looking at the fine prints in the budget, people from all over the world, the industrialists, the investors, are all looking at India as the budget proposals so that it know it will help their economic activities. So everybody in the world had high expectations. Among the important segments, which is highlighted by the finance minister and today also stressed by His Excellency, I would like to focus on, he dealt with at a macro level. I'm going to take two or three aspects within the limited time of 10, 12 minutes given to me and to explain them in greater detail so that the investors in Singapore and the rest of the world could understand how very easy, how very comfortable they will be by investing in India. I would like to focus on the infrastructure segment. All the segments selected by the finance minister are very critical, very important, very relevant and appropriate. And I would like to say a few incentives given in this budget as regards infrastructure. I did one small exercise, sir, with the permission of the panelist and His Excellency and the committee members. I counted out the number of projects in infrastructure and the funds allocated for it. I noticed that 10 lakh crores of rupees, 10 lakh crores of rupees comes for infrastructure allocation. Therefore, the task of the government is to mobilize overall collections and to retain the fiscal deficit at 9.5%. Economists say even this 9.5% is high, but if the collections are not going to pour in as their expectations, the fiscal deficit may widen further. To protect against this, the fundraising resource mobilization in different areas. One thing is monetization of assets. His Excellency also touched upon it. Second thing is disinvestments. Many of you would be interested to know that 1,75,000 crores of rupees have been, they want to mobilize through disinvestment. Earlier budgets also have mentioned this, but what are the special steps? What are the special steps taken in this budget to attract more or to accelerate the disinvestment process? Let me give you this example, the provisions in tax laws. Now, some of these public sector undertakings, while doing a disinvestment, may adopt a demerger mode. When they adopt a demerger mode, is it coming? When they adopt a demerger mode and the losses incurred by the demerged company can be carried over by the resulting company. The present law says there are many conditions which they have to be complied with before they are able to get the loss in the assessment of the resulting company. Very minute detailed conditions are listed out in the law. And if they are going to, all the public sector entities are going to get this benefit, it's going to be very difficult. Therefore, they have introduced a small provision in the law saying that these public sector undertakings, when they are going to demerge, it is not necessary to comply with the strict provisions of law. They have to comply with certain regulations which the government is going to notify. Therefore, my personal view on this is that the demerger of public sector undertakings will be made a little more easier and many more public sector undertakings will get into this path and able to disinvest quickly and efficiently also. It will attract people to do it. And that is why I personally feel that 1,75,000 crores achieving target is achievable, realizable, and practical. So to this extent, let me say, yes, it's a right decision and the correct thing to do at this point of time. The second thing is another point which His Excellency touched upon is the, you see, outside India, we have sovereign funds. We have pension funds. These funds have huge resources in their fold. And India, the cost of finance is very high. The government is attempting to connect these two people. Now, when they are doing that, they have to give some incentives to the investor and at the same time get some funds at a lower rates of interest for India. This is a viable proposal. So what they have done today, the sovereign funds and the pension funds have to invest in the infrastructure, means they have to invest in infrastructure companies or investment funds, what to say, category one and two alternate investment funds. And they must invest 100% in the infrastructure company, 100% in the alternate investment funds. Now, this is going to be a difficult affair. Practically, it may not be very convenient for them to do. So what they have done is they have reduced the minimum investment in this budget from 100% to 50%. So this, to my mind, will accelerate the investment of the sovereign funds and pension funds to infrastructure projects in India. The other thing which the panelists also alerted me, if you want a sovereign fund or a pension fund to invest in India, and if you are asking them to invest in various infrastructure companies, it'll be very difficult for the sovereign fund to oversee, say, multiple infrastructure companies in India. Therefore, very nicely, very appropriately, very correctly, the government has said in this finance bill that they can invest in the infrastructure company through a holding company in India. So all these funds can invest in one company in India, holding company, and that holding company in turn can invest in various infrastructure companies. And the investment which the holding company has to invest is been reduced to 75% and in infrastructure debt companies to 90%. So all these things as a package, I personally believe that it will help the sovereign funds and the pension funds to invest in the infrastructure companies. And if they invest in the infrastructure companies and they start activities, today corporates are busy in preparing the plan for all the products which they are manufacturing in connection with the infrastructure. You must see all those companies which are in cement, steel, they are revising their capital budgets. They are increasing their capacity. They're expecting huge demand to flow. And they are looking into this as a good business prospect. Having finished this part of it, just a couple of minutes of your time on before we commence this presentation, the chairperson was telling that investments from Singapore to India is on the high side. Even His Excellency mentioned it. Now, if that is the case, there are investment funds in Singapore which are investing in investments in India. Now, what is happening is, if the investment fund is going to engage the services of an investment manager in India, and then under the law, under the income tax law, the association of a business manager in India, fund manager in India, will trigger the definition of business connection in India, and whatever profits which the investment activity makes in India will be liable to tax in India. It will be deemed to accrue in India and will be liable to tax in India. But under the existing law, there is a section which says that if it's a fund manager, it will not be considered as a business connection. They gave very specific exemption under the current law. And they said, if it will not be considered as business connection, provided they comply with a number of conditions. The conditions are A to M, Just you can imagine the number of conditions they have to comply with. Now what they have done is, they have said for these type of funds, eligible funds, they need not comply with those conditions. They could comply with, they need not comply, or the conditions will be modified by the government by notification. So things will become a little more easier for investment firms from different parts of the globe to invest in India, and at the same time not being coming within the tax net of India, So this is another significant amendment which will help the investment funds to come to India. I'm just focusing on something which is relating to non-residents. I'll just take one more and be done with it. And His Excellency mentioned that is on the International Financial Service Center. If you have a unit in the International Financial Service Center, you make a profit of it, it's currently exempted. But now they say, if a non-resident is going to open, you're going to function and what's a investment division of a banking unit, he establishes a investment division of a banking unit in an IFSC, in the International Financial Service Center, whatever profits he makes out of it will not be coming, will not be subject to Indian income tax, and he can, it will be tax, completely tax-free. You must see the DTA provisions, whether it is taxable in Singapore. If it is taxable in Singapore also, we take it, and then the balance should be sufficient enough to attract the resources. So overall, the proposals in the budget are investor friendly, and it will attract more investments into India. These are the, and you will find in the recent years, the ease of doing business in India. It has become relatively easier to do business in India, and with the digitalization and information being available to various authorities, I personally believe the steps taken by the government in this finance bill are very relevant, appropriate, and it is in the right direction. It will trigger economic activity. Other areas they are touched upon is affordable housing, startups, research and startups are, they change the way the economy is going to work. We have to develop new skill sets to survive in the evolving situation. We should not blame them for that. We should try to develop, you know, the old saying like SWOT analysis, strength, weakness, opportunities and threats. Same things are there, but change the order now. Don't go for, look the opportunities and what say, have your skill sets and search for opportunities. Find out what the opportunities and develop your skill sets to meet those challenges. If you do that, you will be successful. If you start blaming for what is changing, then you cannot reach any position. This is the loud message I would like to give as part of keynote address. I'm very happy that not only Singapore chapter, all the chapters of ICAI are very active, vibrant, and serving the cause of the profession in different parts of the globe. It gives me a sense of satisfaction that I am part of this profession, and definitely continue to do the good work. And anyway, any small help from my side, always welcome. You could always approach us. Thank you and good luck for the present. Thank you so much. Thank you, Pratima, for the kind words you spread about me also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Indeed, a privilege to hear from you. And as they say, change is the only constant. So, we are all there for the change. And now moving on to our next section, let us all hear from the budget analysis from Mr. Gagan Malik. He's a partner with Ernst & Young and a tax expert. And this will be followed by a panel discussion with CA Payal Tuli from Deloitte and CA Karishma Nagar from PwC. So Gagan, please, the floor is all yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Pratima. I think after listening to His Excellency and Mr. Bhupati, I thought that you have covered everything so well. And so you did three seminars today. I was thinking you will cover tax also, and I would happily listen. But I guess I have to cover some parts. So let me start by saying that overall, to my mind, this was a very good budget, as has been said earlier as well. there was an honesty, there was a fearlessness. And I think that is one point you would have read in media everywhere. It was amazing to see that despite the fiscal deficit, which was aimed at 3.5%, it reached 9.5%. Still, the spending was not stopped. And I think that is clearly evident that India really wants to, you know, take leaps and bounds and go in future. Now, even next year, finance minister did not try and say it will be, you know, lower fiscal deficit, that it will still be 6.8%. Again, the point is that they are ready to spend. CapEx is almost, if I'm not wrong, about 34% more than what was anticipated. And it is compared to FY20, it's almost 60% plus. So where is the money coming from, right? Despite all this, despite the fact that, there is so much of fiscal deficit, there is so much of spending, why did the stock markets rise so much? Why did in 2 days stock market went 8% again? Just because there was honesty in everything which was said. Despite the expenditure, there was no cess, there was no surcharge, there was no COVID tax, there was no inheritance tax, there was no wealth tax. And there was a big fear that some of these things will come. But despite showing that we will spend, there was no increment of taxes, right? So this is a fantastic management which the finance minister has done. There is a heavy investment on infrastructure. There is a heavy investment on healthcare. There is a heavy investment on industries. As Sir also pointed out, there is a heavy focus toward Make in India. And you have heard me speaking in the last few seminars as well on Atmanirbhar India and Make in India as to what government is doing. And for the last 5-6 years, I have been carrying a flag all around Asia Pacific, inviting companies to invest in India and setting up manufacturing facilities. And that took a further step with regards to the announcements made by the finance minister on the PLI scheme, right? Production-linked incentive scheme. So we can talk about that some other day. So with that, what I will do is I will share my screen and jump into the budget proposals. A lot of them has already been covered by our prior honorable speakers. Let me see. Give me 1 second, please. Please let me know once it's visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, thank you. All right, so I think we have already spoken about the backdrop. There were major steps taken through 2020. There were strict lockdown conditions because government wanted to recover and we did very well in that. There was a repayment relief which was given to borrowers. Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative, and we have spoken a lot about in the past few, last session as well. And there has been a significant progress in tax administration, digitization, in terms of faceless assessments, in terms of faceless, even the tribunal, we'll talk about it as we move ahead. There is a significant change which the government has brought in to, bolster the foreign investors' confidence. Corporate earnings, there was a rebound, rollout of vaccines. Now, India is one of the only countries which did almost 300,000 people in 1 day. And there is a target, as I read, of, giving about 300 million people by July, which is almost equivalent to the population of US. It's a significant step which the government is taking. Stock markets have zoomed and there is continuous increase in GST collections. And important to note, the economic survey called for a fearless fiscal policy, and that's what we saw, right? Moving ahead. This is, again, I think His Excellency also spoke about it. This is the first one is essentially being called as bad bank, right? Whereby all the bad debts are being brought in and trying to turn around. So this is a very, very positive step taken by the finance minister. FDI limit in insurance has been increased to 74. And as mentioned earlier on divestment, IPO of LIC is being planned. Again, a very, very positive step. CapEx, we have already talked about asset monetization. So there was a question in the chat, where is the money coming from? And I'm addressing that question right away by saying, by way of divestment, by way of monetization of the assets, which government is looking at, the infrastructure assets, right? Even if you look at the National Solar Mission of India, from an energy side, the renewable energy side, the government is doing a lot in terms of distribution companies. They have allocated significant sums of money towards, you know, distribution companies, because they know distribution companies are suffering right now. And they really want to bring a lot of money into that sector so that it becomes more privatized and it can move ahead properly. Moving ahead, I will jump onto the direct tax proposals. And here, this slide is more on individuals. So I understand it is, I kept this slide usually in my seminar in Singapore. I may not keep it, but I kept it for many of my friends who are here who would want to know as it may be applicable to them. So one is, you know, under ULIP, if you receive amounts on high premium unit linked insurance policies, so any amount received under ULIPs where the premium exceeds 250,000 during the policy term will now be taxable. This amendment will apply only if the policies have been taken after 1st Feb 2021, and they will be regarded as a capital asset resulting into capital gains taxation. Okay, but unfortunately, if you receive on death of your family, then this will qualify for exemption. Similarly, interest earned from recognized provident fund. I don't know how many of you still put money on PPF or recognized provident fund, but now on, if your contributions are exceeding 250,000 after first April, once you receive the accumulated balance, any interest above that amount will be taxed in India. Affordable housing, if you buy houses which is costing less than 45 lakhs, the interest deduction is available for another year, which is up to 31st March 2022. I think this next point is very, very important on ease of compliance. And government has been doing consistently over a period in many budgets. So now the tax returns will be pre-filled with regards to income from capital gains and interest from bank and post offices. So many of you who play a lot in stock market, you know, it'll become easier rather than for you to put it again and again. So this is a very, very positive step. And similarly, there will be a relief for returning Indians for income which they may earn abroad from retirement funds. The guidelines have yet to be announced. Moving ahead, this was something which Sir, His Excellency also talked about. This is in relation to the startups. Right now, if the startups are incorporated between 2016 to March 31st, 2021, with a turnover of less than 100 crores, they're eligible for 100% tax deduction in 3 years out of 10 years, right? But now what the government has done is they have given them another year in terms of incorporation till 31st March, 2022. Similarly, some of us may have decided to sell our assets because we want to, you know, ride the startup wave and have invested our money in a startup. Even on that, the timeline has been increased and there is an exemption from capital gains provided you invest before 31st March, 2022. Moving ahead. Again, it's a small change, but an important one. What is happening is currently, you may need to end up paying interest for default in your advanced tax payments where you have not factored in the dividend income. But government has come back and said, we understand that there is a difficulty on accurate determination of, you know, advanced tax because you're not sure how much dividend you will receive. So now they have covered dividend income as well into that. So there is a relief from an advanced tax perspective. And finally, on the tax audit, again, this is a very positive step. Because it will really help smaller companies. What government is saying is that if your overall receipts or payments in a year are 95% or so in digital payments and not in cash, right? In that situation, you don't need to get the tax audit and the limit has increased to 10 crores from the current 5 crores. Again, a very, very good move. The first one here is essentially taking away sort of dual taxation, whereby now any dividend payment to business trusts will not be subject to withholding, which was earlier subjected to withholding. Because when business trusts make payment to the unit holders, they were withholding. So it's a very good step in avoiding or removing the double taxation. This next step has very, very, given good cheer to the FPIs, because there was a confusion whether their withholding tax on payments being made to FPIs should be at 20% or as per the treaty rate. And now the government has changed it and said it should be as per the treaty rates, subject to treaty eligibility. And this is applicable from 1st April 2021. Now, this is, again, my personal view. This is not an EY view, please. My personal view is this is a change which government has done, which was, I think, long overdue. The issue here is when there is a slump sale is taxable in India. Earlier, the definition of slump sale only included transfer of one or more undertaking. So what is a slump sale? Just as a quick anecdote. When you are wanting to sell a part of your business and assets, an undertaking of your company, you can sell it in lump sum, right? When you do that, that is taxable in India for if it's a cash consideration. What a lot of people did was that they used to do for a slump sale rather than getting cash, they used to get shares. And it was classified as a slump exchange. And the courts held that slump exchange is not within the definition of slump sale and hence not taxable. So government has now come back and said, nope, slump sale will include any transfer which is exchange, relinquishment, and extinguishment. So this is only thing is that this government had promised they will never do a retrospective amendment. I would say to some extent, it is a little bit retrospective because it is effective from April 1, 2020. And hence, any transactions which may have happened before the budget after April 1, 2020 could be impacted by this change. Honestly speaking, to my mind, this is one of the only areas where I'm significantly disappointed. This is one area where it will impact a lot in terms of the deals in India. And I can understand that the government was concerned with it, but the way this amendment has been brought about, it will impact significantly the foreign investors, the acquisitions, the genuine acquisitions. So what exactly is the issue? Today, when you acquire a company, or if there is a M&A or restructuring and your assets are rewritten, let's take an example acquisition. You acquire a company and the assets of the company are 100 million, but that acquisition has happened on a commercial deal and you have paid 300 million. And I'm taking a very simple example. The 200 million you may classify as goodwill and you are eligible to get a benefit of depreciation on that goodwill over a period of time. Now, Supreme Court, in the case of Smith Securities, has held that goodwill of a business or profession is a depreciable asset. Why? Because there was always a confusion whether goodwill is an intangible asset or not. Normally, intangible assets include know-how, patents, copyrights, trademarks, but goodwill was not defined. But after the Supreme Court judgment, it was clear that goodwill should be eligible. Having said that, what government has done, it has now proposed that goodwill of a business and profession will not be considered as a depreciable asset and no depreciation to be allowed. So even where you started taking depreciation benefit 2 years back and you still have a few years to go, after April 1, 2020, you will not be able to claim. So for this year as well, in a way, this is a bit of retrospective change and this will impact significantly the overall. I can tell you one deal, I cannot name it obviously. After this change, there are two deals which have been put on hold because the valuations would now be changed significantly. The buyer would be willing to pay lesser and the seller would not be able to get the valuation which he was getting before this change. So this is an area which is a very, very critical change. I know for a fact that a lot of representations are being made to the government on this. but I just wanted to bring it to your attention. Moving ahead, this was already talked about. Again, you know, I don't know how many of you are aware, but in terms of completing the time limit for assessment, it used to be 21 months, which the government reduced to 12 months. And now the government in this budget has reduced to 9 months. It clearly shows government's resolve to make sure that the disputes are resolved sooner and, you know, investors feel comfortable, and hopefully this will be a very positive step. Similarly, there is a reduction in time limit for filing belated or revised tax return. Earlier, you know, it's in the screen. It was earlier before the end of the relevant assessment year. Now they have reduced it to 3 months before the end of. So 3 months have been reduced. Again, they want to accelerate and ensure that compliances are done on time. This last one is a very positive step. So as of today, the tax authorities can go up to 6 years for reassessment. And this was like always a, you know, a sword hanging on the neck. Not that, you know, if tax authorities had to go back, it's fine if there was something. But this was always an issue with the investors or the corporates or the assessees. And now the government has done that. This 6 years has been reduced to 3 years, which is a very, very good move, a very positive move by the government to give more confidence to the taxpayers. But in case there are actual tax evasion, which is exceeding 5 million, this time limit will remain 10 years. TDS on purchase of goods. I don't know how many of you are aware, and I think this is a move which is confusing a lot of people as to how this will be implemented. And the next slide, I'll show you some examples quickly. But this is something where the government has said that every buyer on purchase of goods from a resident seller. Now, this is very important. It says every buyer, and then it says resident seller. So which means a buyer could be a non-resident as well. So this obligation is to deduct tax at source at the rate of 0.1% on payments made to resident seller on sum exceeding 50 lakhs. Now, this could create a lot of issues, right? And they have defined what buyer is, but very simply put, if you are making a purchase as a foreign company or even in India from a resident seller, and this is for a sum exceeding 50 lakhs, which is huge. And for buyer also, it is defined whose sales turnover exceeds INR 10 crores during the immediate financial year, then you will have to deduct tax at source at 0.1%. This will be very onerous. This will create a lot of obligations on the buyers. So let me show you an example. This is just an example. This needs to be well looked into and researched. Even if you take a picture of this, I would just suggest, it is not something which you should be going with, need to be evaluated in detail. But as an example, if the buyer is a resident, right, and the seller is a non-resident, then the tax collection provisions apply, TDS provisions do not apply. So I'm not going into TCS right now, it's a different discussion altogether. Let's focus only on TDS provisions. So if you look at point 3 and 4, if the buyer is resident and the seller is resident, obviously this is applicable, no worries. But if the buyer is a non-resident and the seller has to be resident, the TDS provisions technically apply the way they have been written. Now, can the buyer claim extraterritorial jurisdiction? Can it claim that this is not liable to tax because I am, say, in Singapore or Hong Kong? Today, technically, as per the changes announced, this will be applicable. So a very important change you need to watch out for if there are any changes made on this by the government, and we will keep you posted, and we can talk about it later. Now, this is another area where I think it has created a lot of issues. I had spoken about this during my last budget speech as well. What has happened is, as you know, equalization levy has been introduced in India, and it was introduced in 2016. And the first time it was introduced in India, it was essentially on advertising payments for advertising services being made to non-residents. And in that situation, the Indian payer was required to withhold, or not withhold, take 6% equalization levy on the payments being made to the offshore or the non-resident supplier. And the obligations on everything was with the Indian payor. Having said that, the Indian government recently amended the rules in the budget and brought in changes with regards to an additional levy, which was on e-commerce supply or service. And here, the change was that now the foreign supplier would need to register in India. So it is no longer on the Indian resident, but on the foreign company. There were a lot of confusions on what amount would this equalization levy apply, on what consideration or what is the definition here included in online sale of goods and services. And government has clarified a few of those things. The first thing which has been clarified is if there is a payment on which royalty or fee for technical services would apply the tax. So as you most of you would know, if I'm receiving income from India, which is in the nature of royalties or technical services, which some of your companies would receive, that is subject to 10%. But if it is not subject to that, then there is an equalization levy of 2%. But where there was a confusion, people were using 2% as the equalization levy because that was cheaper. But now the government has said that if royalty and technical services apply, then that is the rate which you would have to pay, then equalization levy will not apply. The second point on this slide, this is a bit, you need to hear this out because this is something which would really trouble a lot of companies. What it says is that the term online sale of goods or online sale of services has been clarified to mean any one or more of the following online activities. It says if you accept an offer for sale, or place the purchase order, or accept the purchase order, or you pay the consideration online, this will classify as e-commerce supply or service. Now, this is a big, big issue because today we do everything digitally. So let's take an example from Singapore. I'm selling a huge crane into India, right? And I have discussed everything on the phone, but I have accepted the offer on email, and obviously I'll make net banking payment. Now, would that mean that sale is now taxable and equalization levy? It appears technically, yes. I'm just hoping that the intent of the government is only to cover online sales where the network has been used online or there is a sale portal being used online and not every kind of brick and mortar sales. Because if that be the case, it will basically pull everyone into the tax net of equalization levy immediately. So I think this is an area to watch out for. This is an area where we will be seeking clarifications from the government. But as professionals, for all of us who are professionals here, this is a very important point to be aware of because this is something which you would need to, understand and discuss as you move ahead with your companies or the people you interact with. Now, this point as well, the consideration point which has come, this is again a very big issue. And I will very simply explain. And though this is not applicable on Flipkart, but I'm just giving an example. On Flipkart, if I go and buy, say, a television, that television may be sold by Samsung. So when I buy, I pay Flipkart $100. Flipkart keeps $5 for their services and give $95 to Samsung. What is the earning of the e-commerce operator? E-commerce operator is Flipkart. Their earning is only $5. But now the government has said this equalization levy will apply on entire $100. So it says consideration from e-commerce supplier services to include consideration of sale of goods irrespective of whether the e-commerce operator owns the good. And similarly is the situation on services. In services, you buy flights online, now the person, whether it's Make My Trip. And again, as I said, this is applicable to non-residents. I'm just making it easy by giving you an example. So if you do it online, it will now be subject to the entire amount will be subject to equalization levy and not the service provider's fee. So moving on, what government has done is they have defined the term liable to tax. Actually, you know, liable to taxes in many treaties which India has, including with Singapore. What does liable to tax mean? Does liable to tax mean I have to pay tax? Or does liable to tax mean I could have paid tax if the government imposes tax on me? There has been a court case. I think this has been done to change that. So for example, in Middle East, there was a case on a person who received income, but because individuals are not taxed in Middle East, the question, Indian tax authority said this will be taxable in India, but the courts held that even if there is no tax today, because this person is based in Middle East, he is subject to tax if the rules change in Middle East. And hence, he's under the jurisdiction of Middle East. If they change the law, he is still liable to tax wherever they change it. The government has now come up with a clarification saying, or definition saying, this thing has to be taxed. After that, if you get an exemption, that's a different matter. But first, it has to be taxed. And after that, if it is exempted, then it's liable to tax. This actually benefits Singapore companies quite a lot because Singapore shipping companies have been subject to a lot of litigation in India with regards to this word liable to tax, because shipping companies in Singapore technically are taxable, but because of the exemptions under MPA and under specific rules in Singapore, they don't pay any tax. So with this, they are subject to tax, but because of certain exemptions, they don't pay tax. They will benefit out of this amendment, specifically in Singapore. Moving ahead, this is a quick point to, it's not a quick point actually. It is quite onerous for companies now, because what government has said is whether you are making a payment and deducting tax or you are collecting tax, you need to find out that the person to whom you are making payment has been filing a tax return. It's a little bit onerous because now I would need to, while making a payment to someone, first ask him to show me whether you have filed your tax return or not. Because if not, then I would have to deduct tax at twice the rate of what is normally applicable. So again, a change whereby actually government wants more and more compliance, fair enough, totally understand. Has my screen gone away? Kala, can you guys hear me? Okay.
No. Yeah, it's fine. Perfectly fine.
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. So this is something which is
going. Your screen is old screen on page 8 only is appearing. Yeah.
Page 8 or page 19?
Page 8.
Page
6. It stopped there.
I'm sorry.
Gagan, it's fine now.
You can see page 19
now. Yeah. Page 19. You can see page 19.
It's 19, right? Okay, all right. So this is again, as I said, this is a bit onerous on people who have to pay or make payments because now it will be your responsibility to figure out whether or not the other person has filed its tax return. Moving on, very, very positive steps on faceless proceedings before ITAT. I think this is again a beautiful step forward to make tax administration further stronger and more faith in the system. And now ITAT, which is the tribunal, would also be faceless. There'll be detailed directions coming in, and this is a very good step. Okay, on the next one, I'm personally disappointed on the Authority for Advanced Rulings, to be replaced by Board for Advanced Rulings, because I think the biggest benefit for Authority for Advanced Rulings was that if a foreign investor, and I can assure you that I have worked with way too many companies from Singapore, from China, from Korea, who had gone and taken rulings with Authority for Advanced Rulings. These rulings were given by ex-Supreme Court judge. It was outside the ambit of the tax department. It was given by ex-Supreme Court judge. There was judicial member, accounts member, and the rulings were, rulings were binding on both the tax authorities and the taxpayer. The only option was to go to High Court or Supreme Court to challenge that. And this was a very, very positive, step. But now what the government has done is they're replacing it with a Board for Advanced Rulings, which will consist of two officers, not below the rank of Chief Commissioner, which means in a way now Chief Commissioner, which is part of tax departments, would be ruling, and these will not be binding. So to that extent, confidence of foreign investors may go down. I hope government will relook at it. But this is a very, very big change to my mind. I know, Kala, I'm not sure how much time I have. I'm trying to quickly cover. I think this should be my last slide. And this will be my last slide quickly before we go to the panel. On indirect tax, I think I just want to talk about some really, really good things which Indian government has done in the last year or so. So for example, the first one, India had to discontinue MEIS. And this is more because of the trade obligations and WTO and various other things. But government has brought in something called RODTEP. We call it RODTEP, where it's a scheme for exported goods, whereby now this scheme will allow reimbursement of taxes and duties, which were otherwise not available as refund in India in any form. So if you are, you know, exporting goods, you know, exports are not subject to customs duty, but you have inputs. And a lot of those inputs were not eligible for benefit or refund. Now you would be able to, you know, take that refund from the government. Mr. Venkat, I'll charge you. You just took a picture. All right. Next is on Karotar, okay, which is again a very positive step from the government, but this is going to impact a lot of our clients. What the government has done is they have made import of goods into India, the certificate of origin or the country of origin regulations very strict. And that essentially means the people who are importing into India, you know, our clients, our companies, they will have a lot of stress in collecting a lot of documentation from the exporters. And this is an area which is extremely critical. For example, a lot of people were using free trade agreements, say Thailand. And now this country of origin criteria has become really strict. So very simply put, on a high level, be very, very mindful that you need a lot of more documentation to prove country of origin. And it is not as simple as earlier. But this is the right step by the government to make sure that people are not using or not misusing the FTAs. And the last one, it's my favorite, and this all adds into PLI, Make in India, Atmanirbhar India, is government came in with a policy called, you know, customs bonded manufacturing regulations. And I will give you one quick minute summary of it. Basically, what government is saying is, even if you're currently manufacturing in India, or you want to manufacture later on, you can set up the manufacturing facility in a customs bonded warehouse. What that would do is any imports into India of capital equipment, you used to pay huge customs duty and IGST, that will not be payable now. You don't have to pay. It's like a forever deferral till the time you don't move the capital goods out of the factory. If you move the capital goods out of the factory to domestic area, you may have to pay a slight amount of duty. If you, after finishing it, export out, no duty. So it's a permanent deferral to that extent. Similarly, when you import raw materials in India to manufacture, no customs duty, no IGST. Only when you sell the product, you will pay a slight amount of customs duty, no GST, and you will pay GST on the final product. So in summary, absolutely fantastic change. We have a lot of our clients who are setting up manufacturing in custom bonded or even moving their facilities into custom bonded. So this is a very, very positive step. So with that, I will stop screen sharing. I'm sorry if I have exceeded my time. Kala, over to you.
Yeah, thanks Kagan, for your excellent explanation and detailed presentation of the budget. We now quickly move to the panel discussion. May I request Ms. Payal and Ms. Karishma to unmute, please? Ms. Payal and Karishma?
Hi.
Okay. Hi, Kala. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Thanks for joining to both of you. My first question is to Ms. Payal. We heard during the budget presentation that certain restrictions have been for availing input tax credit by a taxpayer. Can you please explain the nature of restrictions and whether there may be any negative impact on the taxpayers as a result?
Right. So just, you know, for the benefit of all the participants, I think what Kala is referring to is amendment that they brought in the GST law, wherein the government is saying that now they will allow an input tax credit only once your credits are reconciled with the returns that the vendors file. So curbing, you know, the GST fake invoices and input tax credit claims has been on the government's radar for some time now, I think right after the GST got implemented. And the restriction that has gotten introduced in this budget is not entirely new. It was always there. It was still there in some form in the indirect tax in the GST rules. So most of the companies have developed a process to ensure compliance. Basically, what the current budget amendment does is to introduce this officially in the GST law. So now it becomes very important for the companies to ensure that their vendors are GST compliant. So they have to go that one extra mile to ensure that, you know, the GST that is getting collected by the vendors is actually being deposited and that the vendors are also complying and, you know, filing the returns. So it does sound a bit onerous because, you know, you not only have to take care of your own compliance, but also look at what the vendor is doing. But, you know, at least over the last 2 to 3 years, we've seen that, you know, the companies have developed the processes and, you know, we also have certain tax technology tools that make this process a bit more efficient. So hopefully, you know, there will be no credit loss to the company. It's just that one extra, you know, precaution that they need to make. And they also need to ensure that they work with the right kind of vendor.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Payal. Now over to you, Karishma. I think His Excellency was also mentioning in his speech about the flows into India. Last few years, Singapore was the source of highest FDI into India. Do you expect more investments from Singapore to India post this budget?
Yes, definitely. For various reasons. So I will start with the tax reasons first and then maybe the other reasons as well. So I think the best part of this budget, as most of the panelists have also said, is that there is very less change in the tax laws. So it brings about a lot of certainty for an investor who's investing in India through FDI that, okay, now that I'm investing, there is certainty in the tax laws. I don't have to have any unforeseen taxes when I want to exit at some point in time. So that is a great change that the tax laws in the last 2 to 3 years have remained consistent and there's very few or little change. There is still room for change and that's what investors are looking at. Changes in the labor laws, which we have seen that there are certain states where there have been changes in the labor law, but the laws differ from state to state. So there's no uniform labor law or common labor law, which is like a guideline for the investor. So they still have to evaluate each state and separately check out the labor laws. Infrastructure requirement. So while there are world-class ports available so that there is connectivity for larger investors, connectivity from the port to the factory or to the customer is still not there. So I think that if there is improvement in infrastructure, and we have seen that in the past few years, infrastructure development has increased in India, but there is still some room for infrastructure development. And I think the third and the important thing.
I think, Karishma, there's a problem in the connection.
Karishma? We are not able to hear.
Okay. I think third and most important thing was to invest in technology. Maybe she was saying that.
Maybe that's it. Okay, maybe I think in the meantime, I'll move to Gagan this question. Gagan, you were also talking about the goodwill in your presentation.
Karishma is back. Karishma, you're on mute.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, continue, Karishma. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a disappearing act. Yeah, so these are some of the expectations that we hear from investors while we are in Singapore. And this is what they look at. So definitely this budget has shown that there will be certainty. There are no retrospective amendments, as Gagan mentioned, there is an amendment equalization levy, but these are more like corrective changes or changes only in the current financial year and not like the indirect transfer laws, which went back to 1962. So that provides a lot of certainty to investors. Plus the Make in India initiative, which everybody has spoken about. India is a country of consumers. So if you have manufacturing more closer to the consumer, investors would be interested in setting up, and with more benefits and incentives and clarity in the law, which would attract investors. Yeah, I think Gagan can also add in something for the goodwill part.
Thanks, Karishma, for that. I think it's a very positive news on which you have told us. And moving to Gagan, I have a question for you on goodwill, which you are also mentioning during your presentation. With this clarification that goodwill would not be considered as a depreciated asset, what would happen to past goodwill and litigation around that?
Right. No, that's an excellent, excellent question. And clearly, I think the finance minister acknowledged in its speech that there is this Supreme Court case. And the fact that goodwill has been granted, depreciation has been granted. So April 1, 2020, any goodwill before that, we should not worry too much. Yes, if it was a self-generated goodwill, the authorities, tax authorities at lower level may try and attack. But having said that, I think it's quite clear that anything before April 2020 should be okay. But after April 2020, even if you had goodwill left on which you were claiming amortization, you won't get it. So to that extent, I don't think there will be any issue for the past goodwill. And even if there is litigation going around that for those years, I am quite confident that the taxpayer should win considering the Supreme Court judgment and otherwise. But after that, now that the government has cleared the law, I think then there is no discussion about it, at least if they don't change it or make any further amendment.
Oh. That's nice. Thanks, Gagan. Sir, Mr. Bhupati, the question is to you. Indian tax authorities have moved to faceless assessments and appeals. And now they are moving to faceless appeals before appellate tribunal, the final fact-finding authority. What are your thoughts on this?
Kala, I would definitely like to say that faceless assessments will save a lot of time. Firstly, it will save your time on commutation. Second, the waiting time in the department will get reduced because it will be very focused and we could discuss those aspects and come out of it. Considering these benefits, the only flip side there would be is when you are preparing for an e-assessment, you have to have your documents done properly and clearly enough for the person to read it and understand it because that should be the document itself should speak for it. So that being the case, we have to see that we create a proper documentation. It is stored properly so that you could retrieve it quickly. And the person who reads it must be able to understand this. This is one aspect. Therefore, personally feel faceless assessments will reduce corruption to a great extent and save our time. So the benefits are far more than the demerits. So I personally endorse the e-assessments. Now coming to appeals. Appeals is a different, slightly different state of affairs. I would like to narrate this, my view, with a small example. When I entered the practice, 76, 77, there was a moot tribunal organized wherein one senior member will act as a tribunal member and two senior members will argue the case for the department and the assessee. A facts of the case was given to both of them where the facts of the case were very strong for one person who was arguing for the department and definitely as per the legal terms he should win. The other person, the same set of facts, he took it up. Both of them presented the argument. One person who was technically sound, but was not good in his presentation skills. The other person, technically he was on a weak wicket, but he was able to present his case well. With the result, he was able to win the attraction of the members and get a judgment in his favor. And the audience were present there very clearly said, technically the argument of the first person was correct, but the presentation wise it is good. So what happens here is, it is possible that when you are making a physical presentation, with your ability to narrate certain instances and relate it with certain case laws, you'll be able to win over. That opportunity people are losing. But I would definitely say that e-assessments or e-appeals also would reduce, when it reduces the personal interaction, the whatever is the unpleasant things which are happening will get reduced. This is my personal view on that.
Okay. Yes, sir. Well said. You know, that will reduce the corruption also, and which is the benefits are far more than the trouble that have to be gone through. Well said, sir. And now to Payal. Can you sum up what is the overall reaction of the indirect tax and customs proposals announced in the budget?
So I think from an indirect tax perspective also, you know, we kind of resonate what we've been hearing, all the panelists also talk, but the proposals have largely, you know, been focused on the two pillars that, you know, the two main focus areas of the government, trade facilitation or ease of doing business, as we call it, and the second one being Make in India. So we've seen, you know, there was an increase in the customs duty rates on many of the imported products and also raw materials and components. And this was done as a, you know, towards to make a push to Make in India. The rates, the sectors or the raw materials, you know, that the government has chosen are also aligned to the sectors that they have picked up for the production linked incentive scheme. So in a way, the customs duty rate and the sectors are aligned. So there is a clear roadmap towards which, you know, the government is moving. And these are sectors like solar, auto components, mobile parts, and the others. And as far as the trade facilitation goes, I think there also we've seen announcements. Last in 2020, customs introduced a faceless assessment in, more in terms of the ability of the companies to be able to make the customs declarations online. I think they're trying to make the interface with the customs authorities more seamless, paperless. You know, Turan Customs is what they had launched last year. And more in continuation to that effort, they now also announced a common portal, which will sort of be you know, a wider portal where, you know, all the registration-related applications and, you know, any other interface and maybe even litigation, show cause notice, summons, you know, all of those aspects, you know, will be all brought to that one common portal. We heard Gagan say that, you know, we were all expecting a COVID test, which did not come in. Which also, you know, in a way is a trade-friendly measure that the government has. So overall, I would say from an indirect tax perspective, you know, we were expecting that the government would have proposals, you know, focusing on these two pillars. So it seems to be a balanced budget.
Okay. Thanks, Payal. Karishma, over to you. Are there any exemptions from equalization levy, like essential services similar to GST exemptions in India? Hello, Karishma.
Sorry, I was on mute. Yeah. So currently, no, there are no specific exemptions from equalization levy like in GST on healthcare or any other essential services. But there is a clarification which has come out in the current budget that if the companies were paying taxes on certain incomes as royalties or fees for technical services, then equalization levy would not apply on such incomes. So there is no double taxation which was happening in the last 1 year or even in the past. Similarly, some good part that IRES has done in Singapore is that they have considered this equalization levy as a business tax and allowed it as a deduction against the income. So for Singapore companies, even though they don't get credit of these taxes because it's not TDS, but they will get a deduction for such expenses paid in India, something similar to what business tax is there in China. So not a win-win situation, but at least there is some leeway in Singapore for Singapore companies.
Okay, thanks. And coming to the last question of the session, Gagan, to you. We spend. With the economic survey calling for an expansionary fiscal stance to ensure a recovery, higher capital expenditure is expected to boost growth. What is the increase in capital expenditure seen in this budget? Can you quickly sum up this? Mm.
So I think, So sorry about that. I think I spoke about it initially that the government is looking at increasing the capex. And I think we have also discussed, and His Excellency also said that, divestments or through asset monetization. So those are the various areas where the government will recover and then invest in infrastructure and others. So I think we just need to have faith, have a strong heart. India always recovers from everything very fast. So I think with all the support of all of us, I think this has been, a fearless budget, and we just need to see the implementation. That is a key. And I'm quite confident, that this would be done in a very good manner. So from my perspective, I think it's very clear in terms of the expenses which the government is looking at on infrastructure, healthcare, which are the key areas.
Yeah, thank you. As you said, so even in your starting remarks, you mentioned very positively about this budget, and we hope so. Now coming to the end of the session, may I invite our Vice Chairman, Mr. Sanjay Panwar, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Yeah. Thank you, Kala. So on behalf of ICI Singapore chapter, we would like to place on record our heartfelt thanks to special guest, His Excellency Mr. P. Kumaran, Honorable High Commissioner of India to Singapore, for delivering his truly pace-setting and very keenly perspective keynote address on Indian Budget 2021. As we understand from your deliberation that this budget is bold and offer not only a direction for a growth, but also a strong intent for reforms, which is quite evident from various infrastructure project, highway building, development infrastructure fund, which is set up by the government. So thank you, sir, for your wisdom and insight shared with us and gracing this event with your presence till the conclusion of an event. Thank you very much, sir. We would also like to thank our Mr. R. Bhupati, past president ICI, for a keynote address. Sir, your presence is invaluable and made this event a great success. The statement made during the speech would provide the incentive to enhance discussion and lead to an understanding of the goal of the Atmanirbhar Bharat by increasing self-reliance and India's ability to become a global manufacturing hub across sectors. We also like to extend our vote of thanks and our deep sense of appreciation to our panelists for most stimulating panel discussion. CA Gagan Malik deliberated an excellent coverage on budget and especially on the topics such as government's effort on making India Atmanirbhar Bharat and its related matters. And it was very well complemented by CA Payal Tuli and CA Karishma Nagar by providing more insight about various indirect and direct taxes provisions and incentives. So thank you very much for engaging panel discussion. As a token of appreciation, we would like to share a certificate of appreciation on behalf of ICI Singapore chapter. Please allow me to share my screen and the certificate with you. Sir, Mr. Bhupati, sir, this is the certificate of appreciation visible on screen on behalf of ICI Singapore chapter for your kind time given to us. CA Gagan Malik, this is the certificate of appreciation for you. Thank you very much for your time. CA Payal Tuli, Karishma Nagar, for this is a certificate of appreciation. And this is for CA Payal Tuli. Thank you very much. Last, we would also like to thank all our members and viewers joined from Singapore and overseas for their continuous support and the participation and the involvement. As you are aware that ICI Singapore chapter has been awarded as the second best overseas chapter, and we wish with your continuous support, we will continue this journey and we'll try to become a number one in the coming year. So thank you all for your continuous support and keeping faith in us. Thank you very much. Over to you, Kala.
Thank you very much, Kala. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And special thanks to His Excellency High Commissioner for patiently listening to us the whole session. Thank you very much, sir. We look forward
Thank you very much.
To see you more in our events. Thank you, sir. And thanks, Mr. Bhupati. Thanks, Gagan.
Thank you.
Payal and Karishma joining us. Thank you so much, and to all the members.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Good evening. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.